Start the recording. All right. So, first thing is I just installed myself a Golang CI lint. So if you Google that, if you Google Golang CI lint, you will get to this GitHub project, and that's the new kind of a meta linter for Go. So there was a project called Go Meta Linter. And it's an aggregator of different tools for analyzing the Go source code, okay? You don't need it for assignment 2, but you need it for a project, and it's actually useful to have it when you're developing Go because it will pick up a number of issues for your project, right? So go to Golang CI-lint, and then they have instructions of how to install it for how to install it for macOS and how to install it on Linux and how to install it on various platforms. So don't use GoGet to install it. Install the binary versions. And then once you install it, you will have... So if I go to Firebase demo, then you have Golang CI lint, and then you say run, and it will execute a check on the project that you're currently in and check if everything is fine with that project. So it will take a while, especially because I just installed it, so it needs to install all the tools and all the extra dependencies, and then it will give you a short report. Okay, so that's just a quick note about the Golang CI. It has been mentioned in the in the assignment 2. Let me see. That's the wrong project, yes. But why am I in the wrong project? Cloud. Yeah, so in assignment 2, at the bottom it said bonus, and by bonus it said use Golang CI lint. By default, about 6 or 8 of those linters are enabled. So to enable everything, all you need to do is you have to have there is a file called Golang CI YAML. So it's .golang-ci-yaml file, and all you need to have in this file is to copy and paste those linters. So this file is in the repo, so you can basically copy the file into your own project, right? If you copy that file into your own project, then it will enable all those linters. So it's a little bit more thorough check than the default one. The default one doesn't have all of them enabled, so it's a little bit less strict. All right, so what we will do today first, I want to clarify about get and payload. So there were some issues with get and payload. So who thinks get and payload is legal, and who thinks get and payload is illegal? So who thinks it's legal to use get with payload? And who thinks it's illegal? So why people who think it's illegal think it's illegal? Have you checked the RFC, what it says about Go and payload? So RFC about REST APIs says that GET allows to have a payload, but the semantics of the payload is undefined, and it depends on the implementation. Unfortunately, they don't say depends on implementation of what. of a web server or of the client code, right? So because the spec is a little bit vague, it is kind of implementation dependent. So on some web servers, it may not work. But in Go and in all the web servers that we are using in the course, it works. So in cases where it doesn't work, you will have to use post with the payload instead of get, which breaks the REST semantics, because you're not, like, if you want to get something and pass more rich parameters instead of the get parameter list, it's nice to use a payload, right? If you have to switch get to post, it kind of breaks the semantics of the REST API. And because with Golang, it works fine, in the last 3 years, we've been using get with payload as if it's fine. And because the specs don't strictly forbid it, then it's fine. Well, having in mind that if you are using some web server which actually doesn't pass through the payload for the GET request, then you may need to have a workaround, right? So it is a little bit implementation dependent on where you will be deploying your solution, but because we're using a built-in web server in Golang and it's fine, it supports GET with payload, then we're using it, right? So in some of the assignments, in some of the points of the assignment, it says that you should pass the parameters via the post, via the payload, but using get. Why? Why we did that? Well, if it's a variable list, if it's a list of project names that you want to do, and you have to put them into the parameter, into a long get request, right? You may exceed the length of the get. The get URL is limited to 255 characters. And if you have longer requests, then you may not be able to fit everything, right? So, and also for a list, it's a little bit stupid. It's much nicer to use an array and put it into a payload than to put it into the URL itself, right? So that's why we chose it. But bear in mind that in some implementations, you may need to swap the get to post. Use the same URL, use the same payload, but instead of using get verb, you would have to use post. In our assignments, you're using get.
Why does post break the semantics? Why is use of post counterintuitive in this scenario? Because in the assignment, you ask to accept an endpoint, right? In C, for example, the rank, the post rank by name. Why is the use of post counterintuitive in this case? What is the semantics of post?
Yeah, exactly. Any other questions about the get request and post? So the second thing I want to talk about is actually the second thing was there was a question: how do we count test coverage? Well, if you have your project and you do go test cover and everything in the project, it will, yes, I haven't run it on this laptop, so it has to compile it, it has to build it, and because I'm using Firebase dependency, it has to install all the stuff from Google, so it will take a while. But effectively, we're doing this command, right? So go test dash cover, and it runs your tests and calculates, and it will calculate the test coverage of your tests. In my case, it will fail because I haven't copied credentials files to this shell. Yeah, I will do that after the break. But after running the tests, it kind of gives you a percentage of how much code is covered by the tests. So that's as simple as that. We don't do any fancy things, just go, test, cover, and this. If your tests don't run, obviously it will not calculate the coverage, so the tests have to run for the coverage to be calculated. So if the tests fail, it is sort of zero because you haven't really tested anything. So you have to make sure that the tests run. I will fix that after the break. So that was the second thing. There was a question about parsing JSON. We did cover that before, but I will just do a very quick refresher on, where is my mouse? The second simple thing, and then we will do, let me see what was next. Yeah, JSON-based databases. So I will kind of use a whiteboard as well. So let me write a little bit. Okay, so we have discussed databases a little bit, but Yeah, we should have a break in 2 minutes. So let me just show you what the exercise is, and you will think about it. So, functions demo. Actually, let me close this one. So I have a simple example with a particular pattern. Okay, so is it readable? So I have people, and people have name, age, and savings, right? And then I have an app which represents my application, and this application has a basic collection of people, right? So I have a particular simple type, and I have some sort of collection of my people, and then I have two functions. First function just randomly initializes my people, right? So we have some data to work with, right? So I can say initialize my app with some random people. So we have some three random people. And then I have another function for my application. And this function takes a function, okay? And this function takes a function which takes a reference to a person and allows me to manipulate my people. Right, so for example, I want everybody to get older by 1 year. Then I have a function which makes everybody older by 1 year. If I want to say, okay, the savings account goes up by 2% because there is annual, you know, interest rate, everybody's savings account goes up by 2%, I can write a function which increases the savings by 2%. Make sense? Very simple use case, right? Clear? Perfect. So here I actually did that, right? So I wrote a function which makes everybody older by 1 year, right? So this function takes a reference to a person and basically makes them older by one. Easy? Easy. Okay, so I created my app. I will print that my app is empty. Then I will randomly initialize it, and then I will apply this function to everybody, right? How did I implement this application? I iterate over all the people and call this function f, which I'm passing here, on the reference to the person, right? Make sense? Anything fishy about this? All right, so let's try it out. So I will build it. Then we will have a break. Go build blah, blah, blah. Functions demo. What should we see? Main. I should see an empty array first. Then I should see my Alice, Bob, and Charlie. And then I should see them older by 1 year. Correct? All right. Two questions and a break. You don't need to answer now, you answer after the break. First question is, why they are not older? Okay? So that's first question. Easy. Second question is, imagine now, I have asked a user by how much everybody should be. So I will get a number here, which says, for example, everybody should get older by 5 years, right? And now I want to do the same thing. I want to call appMap function, but I need to write a new function which will make everybody older, but not like here by 1 year, but by 5 years. But here I cannot pass the parameter, I already have to write a function which only has one parameter. So how can I do that? How can I write? I need to write a function here. So the task is write a function which I can pass to my function here, which will use this number instead of something hard-coded, such that it works even though I cannot pass a parameter here, right? So now a break. First thing is why the students are not older, or the people are not older. And the second, how can we write this function here, right? Okay, break, 10 minutes.